My name is Zainab Bangura. I am the Under Secretary General and Special Representative of the Secretary General on Sexual Violence and Conflicts.
Zainab, growing up in Sierra Leone, you have said that you often did not have shoes, but you had dreams, big dreams, both for yourself and for the women of your country. At a very early age, your father tried to force you in marriage. You were only 12. You resisted, and your mother supported you. How did your own deeply personal experiences growing up in Sierra Leone help to shape this powerful mandate that you hold?
I think at a very early stage, I came to understand and appreciates what it means to be a woman. And I was discriminated against at an early stage because I was a girl. I grew up understanding that at the banquet table there are no reserved seats, that I have to fight for what I want and what I believed in. And that gave me a lot of strength to believe in myself and to set my own goals. I've always said in life, and I've kept that, I don't compete with people, I compete with myself. I make my own mind, this is where I want to get, this is what I want, and this is the way I want to do it. And I pursue it, and I do it with a lot of strong belief that I can achieve it. And I always say, for me, failure is not an option. All the jobs I've had in my life, I have excelled in them because I go with the determination that I have to succeed. And that's the determination which my mother taught me to say, you know, you have to do everything with your heart and just do it. And so that's what has moved me over the period to say nothing is impossible until you do it. You know, people think, oh, this, you cannot do this. It's not possible. But I believe I can. And once I believe I can do it, I take advantage of the situation and do it as well, and always do it better than anybody. I never sit, and I was telling my staff as I was coming to her, she was saying to me, you know, I've worked with you, and why are you so like this? Everything you are prompt, you under. I said, no, that's me. I don't go into a room and sit on the second row. It's not possible. I walk in, I sit, and I always say to myself, if I go to a meeting, if you have one person to remember out of that meeting, it has to be me. So I make my presence felt, and I work very hard so that you don't even judge me, she's a woman. You look at me and said, my God, she is good. That's all I've always wanted.
My God, she is good. And you have always seized that mantle. When you found that the political parties in Sierra Leone were corrupt, you led your own party. You founded your own party. And as the leader of that party, you ran for the highest political office, the president of Sierra Leone. And even when you lost, you were not in any way discouraged. Then you served Sierra Leone as the foreign minister and then as the health minister. And you have said the power for women is in policy making. Can you speak a little bit about the ways in which you have developed new policies in your role as Undersecretary and as the Special Representative for Women and Sexual Violence in Conflict?
It was a very interesting experience with me because what I think I have been extremely fortunate to be an activist, you know, fighting for women's rights on the ground. And I was able to fight for those rights because I understand those women. I was one of them. I went to work in the private sector. I started my career. Then from there, I went to the UN, and I became a government minister. So as a government minister, I realized what it means to make these decisions on behalf of people. When I was Minister of Health, one of the policies I implemented was free health care for pregnant women, lactating mothers, and children born under 5. And I worked so hard that the year before I took the ministry, we had lost 1.5 million worth of drugs. And a year after I took over, not a single dollar was lost because I changed the policies from the time the drugs arrive at the airports to when the drugs gets to the community. And one example I can tell you how I changed was at the community level. In the ministry, they had what you call monitoring and evaluation officer, one per every district. And one district is almost like 500,000 or more people. And I said, if you have one monitoring officer in a district, he has to cover like 50 or so health facilities. When does he go around? And I came with the idea, why can't I identify an old woman? Because women lose their daughters when they go to give birth. They lose their grandchildren, they lose their daughter-in-law. I identify one illiterate woman in every health center village to monitor the facility. I gave her her cell phone. In the morning before she goes to the farm to work, she goes to the health clinic. Are the drugs enough? Are people being asked to pay for drugs? Is a woman there delivering that nobody's attending to? So she sort of monitors and she presses just one number on the phone. It goes straight to a call center in the capital city. She tells them, my clinic is running out of drugs or my nurse is not treating the women. And in the call center, I had a doctor, a midwife. So even if a woman is delivering and the nurse in the village can't deliver, that old woman will call the facility, the call center, and the midwife will take and support the nurse. If they are running out of drugs, she calls the health center, and the health center will then report to the doctor who is in charge of that community. They will send in drugs. So I realized, how do you put these women in control? For me, that was the most important thing. And so when I took the job, having been a minister, being in a policy level in my own country, I tried to engage this government the way I would wanted somebody to have spoken to me. Because you are a minister, sometimes you don't have the facilities, you don't have the equipment. Somebody comes and says, you do this, you do this, you do that. So my interaction started, I came with the thing, I said, it has to be national ownership, leadership, and responsibility. The UN can adopt as many resolutions as they can. The job to be done is how you turn these resolutions to solutions on the ground. And to turn these resolutions to solutions on the ground, it means you have to give power to the people in the community. You enable them, you put them in charge, you build their capacity, you strengthen them, and you empower them to take ownership. And say, this is your problem. My job is to walk behind you, but you have to lead. And so in a lot of the, so I sort of change that and say, yes, I'm a UN staff, I have this mandate, but the problems are on the ground. Where the crimes are being committed, I have to work with the government to ensure that the laws are in place, to ensure that the women who suffer from this crime can get the services that they need, and to ensure that the people who commit the crime are put behind bars, and to work with the police to make sure that they're able to investigate in a way in which they can collect the evidence, protect the evidence and the witnesses, and actually deliver the evidence in a law, court of law, that you can be able to have successful prosecution. So it's a matter of engagement, it's talking, it's working, it's changing the dynamic of the relationship with the people who are actually affected by the problem. So that's what I have tried to do, and I have succeeded extremely with most governments. So even governments like the DRC, you know, and South Sudan, and Somalia, who normally don't want to talk about it, but my approach to them, say, you know, I've not come to tell you what to do, I've come to help you. You know, I was a minister myself. These are the problems I had, and these are the ways I solved those problems, and so I've come to work with you to help you solve the problems. So that's what I have done.
You carry out your mandate at a time that the world faces unparalleled conflict. But it is also a moment in time when there is hope. The Sustainable Development Goals were just adopted. We are having this conversation against the backdrop of the 16 days of activism to end violence against women. Most recently, the study on 1325, Security Council Resolution 1325, was launched and called for the strengthening of women at the policymaking table. At this period in time, what is the message that you want the world to hear? If there was one message that you wanted to make using the University of Pennsylvania's law school as your platform,
What is that message that you would want to make loud and clear?
I think for me what is extremely important is that you cannot move the wall ahead when you leave behind 50% of the population. Women constitute 50% of the global population. In countries like Somalia, they're 60% because of the men. And I think that's what they're going to have in Syria, because from my investigation information we have, there are a lot of communities in Syria and villages now where you have almost 100% women. The men are either fighting the war or they have left. And therefore, it is extremely important the talents that women have, the potential, opportunity being given to them to be able to move countries forward. I mean, I give you the best example is Japan. We're working with the Prime Minister of Japan, who all of a sudden has realized that if Japan needs to move forward the next 30, 40 years, he has to have more women in positions of authority. So he's gone out now as a Prime Minister of Japan to change the policy, putting laws in place to get more women so that women have more time when they give birth to go off work, to come, to don't lose the opportunity. So I think the important thing that women form the fabric of society. Women are the glue that holds society together. The strength that we have as women in us and the qualities of care, of nurturing, of building life, if we convert those qualities into governance, into all the spheres of life, the world will be a different place. So for me, I think with the world, with all the crises we're going, we have to ask ourselves, why is the world in so much problems? We have to think about it. And I think if we start thinking about it and we get women involved in finding the solutions, we can actually be able to move the world forward. So the one message I have to get everybody to understand, that you need to bring women on the table. It is extremely important, and it is for me, it's a very urgent issue that we have to address.
You have, together with Secretary Hillary Clinton, often said that women are not victims, they are agents of change, and that they are drivers of progress. Despite that understanding, despite that deeply and profoundly moving statement, the truth is that women are often victims of sexual abuse in countries that are in conflict and in post-conflict. And you have brought a fierce tenacity in addressing some of those issues, but you have also made visible the fact that men and boys are also victims of sexual abuse. You have, in your work, broadened the definition of your mandate to include, in very thoughtful and meaningful ways, the ways in which attacks, especially sexual violence against women, has intergenerational impact. It leaves scars far beyond the women's bodies or their psyches. The children born out of rape are often called snakes in the African community. Their scars and those wounds are very difficult to heal. Can you speak a little bit about the intergenerational impact of violence in conflict?
Thank you very much. If I take the case of Bosnia, where we had about 40 to 50,000 women who were raped. If I take Colombia, where you've had a conflict for over 50 years, and a lot of children have been born out of those conflicts, those children in Bosnia, a study was done, the mothers of those children born out of rape develop more trauma when the children become adults. Because when the children are young, the mother say, oh, your father died in the war, he was not here. And then when the children are older, now they start to ask, you mean my father didn't have a sister? My father doesn't have a brother? You know, and so they're asking more questions because they are old enough. The women not being able to provide the answers have suffered from more trauma than when they were even raped. So it's a lot of problem. It creates an identity crisis. In Syria now, what we have discovered, I visited Syria, the Middle East, Syria, Iraq, Jordan, Lebanon, and Turkey. And I found out that because the laws of that region is based on Sharia law, you cannot register the birth of a child other than through the father. So we're having thousands, at the moment it's almost 40,000 of children without identity who are going to end up being stateless. So they actually don't have an identity or a country they belong to. And that's going to be a breeding ground for extremists. Because when these children grow up, they can't even travel. The same thing in Bosnia, because they can't ask for a passport because they need to have a birth certificate. In the birth certificate, you need to have the names of the parents. In Jordan, I met a woman who actually was raped. And because she wanted to keep the baby, the rapist was actually in jail. She had to go to prison to marry him so she could give an identity to her son. So, you know, and in Croatia, a boy who learned that his mother was raped and the mother had a son, the younger brother, she couldn't believe when she had it. She went and asked the mother, "Is this true?" The mother said, "Well, that I heard that my brother was born out of rape." The mother said, "No, it's not true." He said, "I'm happy because I should have killed him." So the pain, like you said, it's a scar that never heals. It's with you. It's a wound that never closes. The child reminds you. In DRC, I came across a woman who had a baby born out of rape. Every time she looks at the baby, she tries to strangle the baby because the baby reminds her of the five men who raped her. She didn't know who was the father, but five men raped her. So every time she sees the baby, she actually tries to strangle the baby. So this is the reason why trauma counseling is one of the first things we actually make sure victims go through. And now, I haven't come into the Middle East to the Yazidi girls, so my campaign is actually having government to take these victims out of Iraq and actually provide proper trauma counseling for them so the girls could move on with their lives. So it's a trauma that is transferred from the mother to the children. But it also affects the community, because in conservative society like the Middle East, fathers actually kill their wives or their daughters or use early marriage as a coping mechanism when all of these incidents happen. So rape changes the behavior and everything of the mother and the child. So it's very, very difficult. So it's not only a crime against an individual, it's a crime against a family, it's a crime against a community. So it affects the individual, it affects the family, it affects the community and the society.
These are horrific, unspeakable crimes, Zainab. And you have often said that women's bodies are the cheapest weapons of war. It is far easier to use a woman's body as a tool of war and far cheaper than a machete in a war or conflict situation. You have also, in your crisscrossing around the world, created a paradigm that sees the nexus between illicit mining and violence against women and violence in conflict. You have also, in very meaningful ways, expanded your mandate to cover those crimes of sexual abuse against boys and men, which you have said often happens in a shroud of invisibility, because men and boys, because of, you know, taboos of machismo, are not willing to speak out about these crimes. But more, we have men speaking of sexual abuse as a horrific crime against humanity, the more that the world will listen and take note that sexual violence is a crime against humanity. So I think what you have done is really to redefine security in ways that include both voices of men and women who are victims and survivors of violence.
It's for me, I think the issue of sexual violence, as I keep saying, is one of our biggest moral issue of the century. You know, one of the most painful experiences I went through is when I spoke to a Bosnian man who, under tremendous tears, was telling me how he was raped during the Bosnian conflict, how he was forced to rape his own son. And up to today, as I speak, he's never been able to face that son, never been able to see that son. And in Colombia and in the DRC, they used rape to drive people out of areas that are rich in resources. When I went to Colombia in Choco department, because of the narcotic trade, because they know that once you introduce rape into a conflict, you so terrify the people that they live in drones. And that's what happened in Syria as well. Once rape was introduced into the conflict, most of the people ran away to save their wives, to save their daughters, to save their mothers. In the DRC, because in rich areas where they have diamonds, and to drive the people out of those areas so that they could take control of those mining areas, they start raping the women. And that creates a challenge for women, and the women live with their families and everything. So it's being used as a weapon of war. And of course, in the Syrian conflict, it's being used as a tactic of terror because it's used, and sitting down listening to the Yazidi girls, they tell you how in a, when the ISIS enter a village, how the men are slaughtered, the women are separated, the virgins are put in a different room, and they are cleaned up, they are put into open market, they are sold like cattle. It's just unbelievable. So along the way, over the period, we thought that we have actually worked very hard in developing and ground legal framework in the UN. But within the last 3 years, with the introduction of extremists, from Mali to Libya to Somalia to Nigeria to Yemen to Syria to Iraq, we've seen a whole different dimension in a very sophisticated way, wherein sexual violence is being used as the currency which ISIS is fighting its conflict. They use it to promise men, young men, come, you have girls here, virgins, you can marry 2, 3. They sell the girls in the open market, they use the money to fund their war. They use those girls to get ransom from their families. It's just on and on. I met a young woman in Jordan at a shelter. She was 21 years old. She had been sold back and forth 22 times. Every time she's been prepared to be sold, they get a doctor to stitch her to make her a virgin, and then they sell her to the next person because a virgin fetch a higher price. They even have a price list. They have a manual, they have an office, a bureau for marriage, you know. And so it's unbelievable how they have institutionalized sexual violence and calling it so-called that it's in Islamic. But it's getting worse, but worse. And so since I returned back, my campaign has been engaging the coalition member from Washington, Kerry, to Canada, to Germany, to Sweden, traveling all this country, and actually getting them to understand that you cannot talk about ISIS without talking about the protection of women. ISIS, the protection of women, have to be embedded in the counterterrorism strategies. And so I've been extremely lucky to be able to get to accept that. And now the counterterrorism document, plan of action, that the Secretary General is going to present to the General Assembly actually has a whole chapter and detail on the use of sexual violence and how we have to work to protect women and empower them if we're going to fight terrorism. So across the range, whether it's natural resources, whether it's displacements, whether it's counterterrorism, the issue of women has, that tells you how important we are as women, and they need to be able to pay a lot of attention on how everything affects our life and what we can contribute to make a difference.
No one has worked as hard as you have to make sure that the protection of women is central to security sector reform. But in doing so, you have also faced many challenges. There has been a backlash against you, against women on the ground who raise their voice in opposition, and you have faced some hostility. How do you cope with that, and how can elite academic institutions and law schools like Penn Law School help you in advancing your mandate?
I think I start from the bottom of the question with regards to what Penn Law School can do. I think there's a lot still we have to learn. You know, I say sexual violence is the longest silence crime in history, which nobody wants to talk about. The history of conflict has always been written by men. Mm-hmm. If you go back to the Second World War, mm-hmm. nobody realized, knew that during the Holocaust, a lot of women were actually sexually abused. Because why? The people who wrote the history of the Second World War were all men. So we still have a lot to understand about sexual violence, the trend, the pattern. And so for law schools, it's important in terms of in-depth research and analysis that will feed into the work we do that will help us to be able to look for solutions. So I think it is extremely important in that regard. The second regard, universities have a lot of young people, both men and boys, who today's world, I mean, when did I have a cell phone? You know, my son, you wouldn't believe it, I didn't have a Facebook page until when my son came to visit. I said, Mommy, you need a Facebook page. And he taught me how to do it. So I think using the social media and the information age, which young children are very adept to it, in the network, the chat room, the groups they form, will help to launch campaign, to raise awareness, to send the messages. If you look at what they did with Bring Back Our Girls, it wasn't success, but it raised the awareness until at the stage where heads of state, where the first lady and everybody in the US had to join. So I think it is important how you mobilize the young people around the cause and get them to understand there can be no bystanders. I mean, one way or the other, we're all affected. So as women, we have an obligation. And I say, when a woman fails, I fail. So it is important that we do everything possible to protect, because for victims of sexual abuse, they live over the shadow. They live behind the curtains. They are so ashamed. They have been so stigmatized. When I visited Somali, 70% of the women who have been sexually abused have been abandoned by their husbands, family, and communities. What do we do for these women? So the victim is left to carry the shame. And the perpetrator, as in Bosnia, as in DRC, walk free. In Bosnia, the women said to me, you know, we see them in the buses. They are the bus driver. They are the military. They are the police. He's the teacher of my child. In school, the child I got out of rape, he is the teacher. I can't say anything. And they intimidate the women. So we really need to work hard to try to be able to do that. And I think it brings all of that in totality for, say, how do we launch a campaign among women and connect them? How do you connect women who have gone through this crisis in countries to actually engage with young girls so that they could be able to help? So we still have a lot to do. And women, of course, I mean, for example, in Colombia, most of the human rights defenders have been shot dead. Mm-hmm. So that's why in Resolution 2106, we really insisted that we have to protect the human rights defenders. The victim who comes out in Guinea, because it's a deeply religious community, when about 109 women were raped in the stadium, when the women came out and spoke, their husbands threw them out of their houses. You were seen as, I don't want to say there was a trash. In the DRC, I met a woman who has 5 children. She was raped and she got pregnant. The family of the husband said, we're not even too sure our son had the other five children. So she was thrown out of the house. So all of this means that we have to find, how do we give livelihood support? I went to the ICC and we're working with them now. We're successfully, they've got now a program on reparation. Because I said to them, it's one thing, for me, justice is about making sure if somebody rapes me, he's locked up. But for a woman in a village who has no access to land, who has no education, and who has no livelihood support, being thrown out, justice to her is different, because what she wants is a house to live in. She wants a piece of land to grow the food. She needs economic resources to educate her children. Mm-hmm. So justice to her is more related to reparation. So we need to work out. And when I explained that to the judges, they were like, I'm sure they were going to value reparation in terms of the number, the resources you earn, your earning capacity, but that's different. So that's why a lot more work needs to be done by institutions like yourself to help educate people, to be able to understand the problem is here, what needs to be done, how it can be done. And every time I tell my staff, it's like the onion. Sexual violence is like onion. You peel one skin, there's another down. You peel one skin, you see, oh, boys, men and boys. Oh, my God, I didn't realize that men and boys were raped. Why? Was because mostly men and boys are raped in prison. And so when it is documented, it comes under torture. They don't want to talk about it. You go back, oh, in areas with mining resources, women are raped because they don't want them there. Then you pull the other, oh, in refugee camps. Why? Because there are no lighting facility. The sanitation things are built on at the back of the the refugee camp, women have to go out at night. 70% of refugees are women. So when they go out to use the bathroom at 2 a.m., somebody is acting around behind the bathroom, he rape her. Or because the tents don't have doors and they don't have any lights, which now we're talking, by the way, with UNHCR to put solar lights in refugee camp, because somebody can just crawl and goes into her tent and rape her at gunpoint and squeeze her mouth so she can't say. So every time you peel one, you find out, oh my God, this is a problem here. And I think that's what is important for us. So we've not, it's just a tip of the iceberg. The more we go into it, the more we find more information. And every problem we discover, we have to look for solutions. Mm-hmm. And that's what our job is. But if we don't understand it, we cannot look for solutions. So that's how we need to work together. So you help us to design the trend. When women go to the market, they walk to the market. Or when women in the protection, civilian protection sites in South Sudan, they go out to get food, they are raped. So the husbands refuse to go out because they will get killed. Instead, they send their wives and mothers and daughters, because the wife and mothers and all will be raped, but at least they will come back. So what do you do to make sure the women don't go out, to bring all the services they need into the camp so that you can protect them? Because if they go out to fetch water, that's why they get raped, because the people know that they go at this particular time to get water, and this is where they go, and they do ambush them, and they rape them. So it's on and on. As you peel the onion, you find more areas that where women becomes vulnerable, at the checkpoints, detention facilities, border crossing, in house-to-house search, everywhere, the woman is vulnerable.
Zainab, it has been such an honor to conduct this conversation with you. I see you as the world's chief witness and the world's chief storyteller, because you amplify the voices of the women who are victims of sexual abuse and sexual violence. And as the world's witness, you're the conscience of the world. And you tell these stories before the Security Council and before the heads of states, of governments, and hold them accountable to what you have called the great moral issue of our day. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.